Fill her up.
You're listening to the Gas Digital Network.
And we're back. It's Gomez Watches Seinfeld.
What up, what up?
What up, what up? Yada, yada, yada. How y'all doing? What's going on, Jen?
Pretty good. How are you?
Are you doing good?
Never better.
I have a little bit of anxiety, and I will say we're going to get into this show right now, but I got to... Mike Harrington
is... So many things to give you anxiety this week.
He's on thin ice.
Wild.
He's on thin ice here. Okay. Harrington, he's 2 hours late to the show.
It's wild that he has the audacity and to walk in the way he did.
Yeah. Like, hey, guys, I'm so sorry. Like, you know, I understand this is a massive opportunity working with Jeniece Gomez. This is like my fantasy. And you see,
all the money of the show goes into Mike Harrington's pocket.
By the way, literally, we don't make anything off the show. The only person who makes money off this show is Harrington. Yet still today, two hours late.
Be ashamed to call my boss with the excuse of, and his excuse.
It wasn't even like he could have made up anything.
I mean, I would have been like, there was traffic. Listen, the parkway, there was an accident. I would have bought it. I would have been like, it's icy out, you know.
The train froze.
Anything.
The train froze
anything.
In a tunnel.
No cabs in the city running. Okay, sounds all right, maybe.
Yeah, I was mugged on my way here. I was shot. I'm thinking of things that I want to happen to Harrington.
Didn't even bother with any of it.
I was raped by a gang of... Dominicans on the way there. Harrington, what the fuck is going on with you? How are you showing up 2 hours late to Gomez Watches Seinfeld?
Hungover like a dog.
Is he hungover like a dog? He doesn't drink.
Something's up. I don't know.
He doesn't drink. Do you smoke weed again?
He looks so bad that I was like, is this coronavirus related? Like, I was concerned. I was like, are you sick?
He's coughing now.
He's coughing. Like, I know.
There's a lot. He's coughing a lot now. Now it looks like it's painful.
Like, you ever, I mean, and I even took pity on him. I said, all right, Harrington, it's fine. We've all had those days because we've had those days.
We've had those days.
Yeah. Remember back when we were kids, we had those days.
But it's a lack of respect because you think that he would just lie. He said,
anything.
I'm going to read the text from him. I know this is like against guy code. You're not supposed to read texts from each other. But this is crazy. Right? I said, where are you? This is at 3:30. This is a half an hour after you were supposed to be here.
We're supposed to start.
I was like, where are you? I didn't even notice because I'm having an amazing time with my family. My sister's here. My Aunt Anna Maria's here. Bianca, James, my chicks upstairs. Everyone's having this great time. And then I looked down. I was like, we were supposed to start this podcast.
Came back from the park early with the kids. They were having such a good time sleigh riding.
I took them sled riding.
He said, sleigh riding, tubing.
Say sleigh? Who says sleigh? I feel like a sleigh was in the 1800s.
Sleigh riding, yeah.
You go to grandmother's house on a sleigh.
Yeah, on a sleigh.
On a sled, you go down a hill for fun.
No, a sleigh. Sleigh riding sounds classy, like class.
Okay. So I took them to the park to go sled riding, and they were begging me to stay at the park. Begging me. Like, please don't take us home. I said, guys, I'm so sorry.
Harrington's
I love you guys
on his way.
So much, but I can't be late for Harrington. I need to make sure that I'm there in order to do Gomez Watches Seinfeld. The fastest rising show on the Gas Digital Network.
What an asshole you look like.
I know. And then we get back and the kids were like, where's Harry? Both of them have been crying for 90 minutes.
They went out in the yard. They were like, well, we'll go out by ourselves, I guess.
They just sat on a sled. They sat on a sled in a stationary position because they could not, there was no hill to go down. No, just sitting there, just sitting on a sled with sad looks on their fucking face. Harrington, how do you feel?
Because what was the excuse? We didn't even get to it.
Oh,
what
sorry.
Was the excuse?
And I quote, Harrington, nobody forced his hand here.
The ball's on this guy. It's unbelievable.
Nobody forced his hand. It's crazy. This is at 3:36, 5 minutes after I text him, where are you? He goes, I fell asleep, just woke up, waiting on a lift now. And it was, I fell asleep, comma, just woke up. Semicolon, waiting on a lift. Now, I don't even know if that's grammatically correct.
He might as well have finished. Fuck off. Stop texting me.
He's fucking writing me a book with your punctuation, asshole. Okay? Yeah, I'm sick of it. A semicolon is a very passive-aggressive thing to put in a text message. Nobody's ever put a semicolon in any text message unless it was somebody that they had no respect for. Fact.
He's unbelievable. Fills up with a dog, and then he just wanders in with a dog
that
with an attitude.
Bit me.
That bit you.
That fuck. The dog
lawsuit
comes in.
On the, I'm excited.
She has Corinne Fisher's dog. Shout out, guys. We fuck podcast. I go to give the dog a piece of bacon because at that point, we didn't even go get lunch.
because we had no,
we were waiting for him to
like, you know, fuck it. We're not going to watch.
With our earphones on, like,
I shit you not, the children have not eaten lunch, Harrington. It's 5:40 p.m. right now. The children have not eaten lunch. So I have some snacking bacon from Dunkin' Donuts. I sent my girlfriend to go get some Dunkin' Donuts. I was like, well, we can have some bacon, guys. That's fine. The dog
comes
in. Shout
out Dunkin' Donuts.
Shout out Dunkin' Donuts. Loving it. Okay. There we go. Everybody runs on Dunkin'. I go to give this dog a piece of snacking bacon. You know what the son of a bitch does? He bites my
goddamn
finger.
Fingers off.
He bit my goddamn finger. So Harrington is bringing not only lateness and anxiety and a lack of fun and enjoyment and memories for my child and food, but he brings in a wild beast that attacked me in my own fucking home. Now, also, this beast, every time Harrington's not in the room, whines.
Shut up.
There's nothing more, and I mean this, and Corinne's going to probably hear this and be upset when I say this. I might put a drill through that dog's fucking head.
He's kidding.
I might take a drill bit and put it through its fucking head before the end of the day if it keeps whining every time Harrington leaves the room. I have the same reaction.
For Harrington. I'm like, what is wrong with you, dog?
He whines every time Harrington leaves. I have the same reaction every time Harrington enters the room. I start whining and scratching at the door to get out. Please let me out of this fucking room with Mike Harrington. So anyway, welcome to Go's Watch a Seinfeld. And what is it, episode 7 right now? Wow. Seven weeks down. We are reviewing season 2, episode 2, The Pony Remark. How many bagels? Are we doing the bagels at the end?
No, I want to start it off.
We'll start off with the bagels. How many bagels?
How many bagels?
How many bagels?
How many bagels?
I asked you first. You can't. How many
five
bagels?
Five goddamn bagels.
Jenny, you can't give it five bagels.
Yes, five bagels.
You can't give it five bagels.
Five bagels on
the
dot.
This is the best episode that's ever existed.
Yes, this is my favorite. I was thinking to myself, if I was gonna refer somebody to Seinfeld, I would start with this episode.
You haven't seen any other episodes.
Yeah. From what we've seen, if you said, "Oh, hey, let's start watching Seinfeld," I'd be like, "All right, let's start right here." I'd skip all of the first season. I would skip like last episode. I'd watch last episode, but
I'll
I would
tell you
start right here. I thought it was so funny.
I agree with you that this is the best episode we've seen so far.
See?
I'm giving it 3.5 bagels.
What?
Three
You're
and
so
half.
Stingy.
There
you
has
suck
to be
so hard.
Room.
Oh, my God.
And as an homage to Seinfeld, I'm being very stingy with my bagels, okay? It is 3.5 bagels. That is the highest review I've given so far.
You have to have 5-star episodes. You have to have episodes, like a library of episodes where you can say, okay, this episode in season 2, 5-star.
This
star.
Is not
this
the,
one, 5-star.
The,
star. This
Jenny,
one, 5-star. These are my favorite episodes.
You're going to go back and you're going to want to re-bagel that.
No, I'm
you're
not
going to. You're going to want to re-bagel
nope,
that.
That's a 5-bagel episode.
I guarantee you. Because later on they say season 3, season 4 is where it gets crazy. That's where it gets really funny. But I see in this episode for the first time, I have seen just little glimpses of interesting, unique writing. So what happened in this episode, a lot of the times, there was this randomness to like a lot of the characters, like George, when he's at the diner, he's thinking about getting laid when they're talking about something else, when they're at the party, you know, Elaine's on focus on, you know, the apartment.
Yeah.
There's a few moments in this where it was like, okay, this is sort of clever the way they wrote.
It was
these
very well timed jokes. I thought.
Yes. By far the funniest.
Yeah.
I laughed at Jerry more in this episode than I've ever laughed at him ever before.
Yeah.
So let's get into the episode. First of all, what is the air date? When did it air?
January
30th, 1991. Okay. And what was the number one song in the country
nothing,
at that time?
Nothing great. First Time by Surface. I don't even know this song.
Get the time to share together holding hands.
Yeah, for the first time in his goddamn life, he tried to make an effort.
Ironically, the first time Harrington's come prepared for anything.
I feel like when he does something good, he feels like he can fuck up for the next week.
January 30th.
Yep.
When did that movie premiere? Harrington, look that up. When did Home Alone premiere? How long did it take the box office number one seat? And how much horseshit came out that winter?
I think the next week, too, it is again.
No way.
Yeah. Wow.
It's been the number one movie in the country.
For almost 3 months?
For nearly 3 months. Home a fucking Alone.
You killed it.
That's absolutely wild.
I was thinking, what would you do if I treated James like Uncle Frank treated...
Kevin?
Yeah.
I didn't remember his name.
You know, the kid.
An iconic
The kid.
It's an iconic name.
The kid. You know what I'm talking about.
I wouldn't be happy. I wouldn't be happy. But it, you know what it is? Like, I think the reason why, I don't know if movies would stay in the number one position for that long anymore.
Yeah.
With the amount of other things that are going on with Netflix and HBO Max and Disney Plus and all the things that are going on, the internet, people.
You think movies are going to come back?
Yeah, but hold on, let me finish this point. The movies was this, like, it was one of the, a major source of entertainment back then and to cure boredom. You had television, but even television, there was what, fucking 50 channels back in 91 at the most? I don't remember how many channels, but not very many. There was no internet. There was no nothing. So going to the movies was a big fucking deal. So everybody went and saw this movie and they kept on going to see this movie. What other movies came out during that time? What was competing with this that people did not like?
I have no idea.
Harrington, look that up in the meantime. Give me some movies that came out 1991, January. I want to know. Wait, what did you just ask me?
I said, I don't know. I don't know.
No, would you ask me before that? You asked me a question.
Movies are coming back.
I think they're going to come back, but I think they're going to come back in a very, like, different capacity. Going to the movies is not going to be something that, like, is the classic go-to all the time anymore. It has shifted. Now, honestly, people saw, and I saw this, when you can fucking sit at home and a brand new movie premieres for $20, you can all get around the TV, that's a more enjoyable way to watch a movie.
Yeah.
Going into a theater where you sort of have to act a certain way, like when I want to watch a movie, I want to kick my feet up, take my shoes off, I want to fucking be able to fart, burp, I want to do whatever. And I do that in the movie theater as well, but I want to feel comfortable doing it in my own home. $20 for a movie is fucking...
Yeah, that's pretty good.
It's pretty damn good.
I mean, you don't miss the experience, though. I kind of miss the experience.
I mean, you can still go to the movies right now in Jersey. There's a movie theater open 5 minutes from here.
Yeah, we did. Over the holiday.
You went?
Yeah.
What'd you say?
Bianca's friends did Christmas Story.
Okay. That was fun. Very cute. Mm-hmm. Very cute. So, all right. So, number one movie in the country. That's fine. And what is your fucking wrestling thing?
It wasn't great. We'll move on.
Jenny or Harrington, what other movies came out during that time? Look Who's Talking To.
What? That was so good.
You like Look Who's Talking To.
I love Look Who's Talking To.
With Roseanne Barr as a little girl. Bruce Willis as the little boy.
Yeah.
But the boy could actually speak, but he still had an internal monologue of Bruce Willis.
Yeah.
I don't.
John Travolta's finest work.
What else came out during that time? Predator 2. A lot of sequels. Kindergarten. Okay. Arnold Schwarzenegger. So let's talk about the episode. Starts off with some stand-up at a family gathering. Nothing really memorable from that, but they cut to Jerry's apartment, and Jerry's parents are there. Do you remember his parents' names? Is it Mort?
Yes.
What's the mom? You don't know. Fuck it. So they're in the apartment. They're hanging out on the couch. Jerry comes in. What's the first thing you noticed?
I noticed the softball, which I think an adult man playing softball is kind of silly.
First thing I noticed, he was wearing gray sweatpants and his dick was dangling, doggy. His dick was dangling.
Yeah?
Yes. He's got a big old fucking Jew cock. And I'm sure Bobby's pulling it up in the behind us on the green screen.
I hope so.
I want a close up of Jerry's thick gray sweatpants.
If I watch the playback on this, I would love to see it.
It's bouncing, it's moving, it's thick. It's fucking way thicker.
He's having fun with it.
We're all having fun with it.
Yes.
Fucking Jerry, dude. Very jealous. I do not have the type of dangle to wear gray sweatpants.
No, you do. You do.
Thanks.
I noticed.
Jesus Christ. No, you're fine. It's great.
It's real thick at the end.
No, I don't have gray sweatpants dangle. I really, truly don't.
Good. I'm glad that you don't. I don't have to see that.
I own a pair of gray sweatpants, and I mean, it's pathetic. I am flat dicked.
Yeah, we see it. It's like a mound.
It looks like I'm smuggling a Mentos in my crotch. It just pokes a little bit. You're like, what is it? Is that his dick? I was like, yes, that is my dick.
Yeah, Anna said something.
What did Amory say?
Kidding me. Let's get out of here.
What did Amory say about my cock?
It looks like a
Mentos. Get that old bitch down here.
Poking through like a Mentos.
So yeah, he comes in and he had been playing, I guess he plays on a softball team, which I agree, it is a little bit strange, adult men that are playing on a softball team.
I just associate it with alcoholism. Like, I just know a bunch of old alcoholics who like to drink and play softball.
Do you know who's on a softball team?
What? Who?
Eddie.
Oh, no. Eddie's so great. So, no way.
Look, this is my sister's opinion. It ain't a big deal. It ain't a big deal.
You know what? My whole opinion just changed. Wow.
I love Eddie. I love Eddie. But you have your preconceived notions about people who play on softball teams.
Eddie.
You broke her fucking heart. Eddie is my son's mother's current boyfriend.
He's the best dude.
He's
we
a great
love
dude.
Eddie. Oh
and I'm
gosh.
Sure he's got some crazy gray sweatpants dangle.
Oh
Let's
my
get real.
God. Not for nothing.
If I was Eddie, I would only own gray sweatsuits. I would seriously just
that
have...
That would get him in anywhere. And he's such a gentleman.
Gray
like,
champion
even be
sweatsuits.
You'd just be like, ah. Oh,
look at that.
This gentleman.
Look at that. Gentleman's cock. So yeah, he and I agree with you. I don't think I've ever played a game of softball in my entire life.
Yeah, I've attended quite a few.
So you have friends who play on teams?
Yeah, in like in restaurant leagues and stuff. Mm. Like they're trying to capture.
Well, that's what it is. I mean, is there any?
Yeah, and they just sit and drink, and it's. So
is good. There? Is there? I can't wrap my head around getting together with my friends and just fucking playing a game like that. Maybe. I mean,
oh
maybe
God.
It's fun. Maybe it's fun.
Maybe,
I mean, look,
yeah,
I just feel like it's also not, like, if I'm going to spend my time doing something like that, I'd rather do something that's a little bit more physically strenuous so you get the exercise out of it.
Yeah,
so
that's
if I'm
going to
play a sport, go play something that's going to really, because softball, baseball in general, it's a fucking, it is the least athletic of all the major sports. And softball's
agreed.
The girls.
I'm thinking for, yeah.
The girls' version. You have
I
to
mean,
sprint.
And
to
I feel
a,
like tennis, I'm running around more.
Tennis is crazy.
Right? Like I'm yeah. I'm just trying
Jenny,
to think.
Tennis is bonkers how much you run in tennis. Yeah. It's just nonstop movement, fast twitch muscle fiber, fucking sprinting one direction, sprinting the
I
other.
I mean, my tennis games aren't that intense,
Jenny,
but okay.
You have to suck dick at tennis.
I'm so bad, yeah.
Holy shit, I can't imagine
and
how bad you were.
Pretty physical, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, so he's playing on a softball team. And he comes in and he's very, very excited because he made a big play in the game. And then he describes this as the greatest moment of his life. Which made me it prompted me to ask you, what is the single greatest moment of your life?
Well, my daughter was born.
Hmm. I guess it is, right?
Yeah. Nothing
did you have a C-section though?
I did, yeah.
I feel like that would dull.
No.
Like, I wouldn't be able to look at my wife the same way if she had a C-section. She didn't deliver our child naturally.
No, I disagree.
So that would probably...
No. What we went through was so traumatic. He wouldn't even agree with you. It was, like, so traumatic and terrifying. Like, he would
Why?
Be like, you're a champion, what you went through.
What'd you go through?
It was just... It's scary. Like, you don't know what's happening. It was an emergency, so that, you know, added an extra sense of fear.
Why
and
was
then,
it an emergency?
Because her blood... Her Well, my heart rate was, like... Like, I was getting nervous because I was getting anxiety. And then her heart
rate... Did you
go
into labor or were you induced?
I went into labor.
Okay.
So I was in labor.
And the moment you went into labor, where were you at? What were you doing?
It was like an all-day thing. It's not like that.
Well, there's a moment where you go, oh, shit, I think I'm in labor. Yes, there is.
No, it was the Sunday before. I was having pains. I mean, not to be disgusting. I had my bloody show. Like, it was almost time. Like, things were happening. So I went to labor and delivery and they, you know, checked me out and they were like, all right, you have some time, you know, come back. They were like I was making jokes and laughing and they like, if you're in labor, you're not going to be laughing. They were like, you'll know it. You won't be able to breathe.
That's how fucking funny this bitch is. a normal human being wouldn't have been able to make jokes and have the composure to do that, but you're just fucking firing
just
them off.
It, you know.
Beautiful.
Yeah. So whatever. So it was just an all day, a couple days. And then eventually I was dilated enough where they're like, all right, you're going to go within the next 24 hours, so they were like, let's put you in here.
Okay. And that was it. So why was it so stressful that Gamera would be happy?
Well, because it was just a lot. Like, you know, the baby's, I'm not sure if the baby's okay. They pin you down like this. Like, I mean, it's terrifying.
That does not happen in any birthing process.
Like this. Like, and you have to keep your arms out. They give you this medicine that makes
were you...
shake like
did you have
tremble.
An exorcism
that's what it felt like
he strapped you down to a bed
and they put like the sheet up and he was like next to me kind of like trying to comfort me
sort of stabbing you in the vagina with a crucifix
that's what it felt like and then the worst part is you don't know like I didn't know that you still feel them touching you so like there's that sensation of them pulling your like and you're you don't feel the pain of it, but you're imagining it. So that was like very traumatic. It was
just when they were cutting you open.
Yeah. And I said to the nurse, I was like, should I be feeling that? And she was like, are you having pain? And I said, no. And she made them stop. And she was like, you know, as long as you're not having pain, you're going to feel them tugging and pulling. Like, I mean, I cried when they yanked her out of me, like how painful it was. Like how.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
It was still painful. You felt it.
I mean, maybe it's just imaginary, like phantom, because, you know, they do numb you. But like, yeah, like it was crazy.
And that's the single greatest moment. It sounds like a fucking nightmare.
Wonderful.
It sounds like nothing beautiful about
it. And my anxiety
There's blood splattered all over the walls. It says, help me on the mirror.
And he sat with me the whole time. He was so scared. He couldn't even look. And a friend of mine worked in the hospital, and she was walking through. And she was like, Jeniece, I saw your insides sitting on a table next to you.
Oh, I wouldn't do that. The nurse made me look at Beatrice's vagina.
Oh my God.
When the head was crowning. And I was like, I was kind of like looking up, like, all right, we're here. And she was like, she took my head physically and turned it toward
the
vagina. Oh my
God,
she's a
monster. Look what's happening.
Yeah, it is. It's not
it's
good.
A lot, yeah.
It's not good. Yeah, yeah. So, okay. So that's the greatest moment of your life. Yep. You know, for me, I mean, I guess obviously the moment my son was born, but let me not say the same fucking thing. Single greatest moment of my life beyond that was, and this is going to sound fucking cheese dick, and it has nothing to do with me being a fanboy. It just is what it is. But when Louis C.K. showed up at Skankfest, it was because I saw how happy our audience was. I've never seen an audience more excited about anything in the fucking world. It was a room of 500 people that exploded with fucking joy. It was the first time Louis was doing something really in this. I think maybe he did one or two other shows, but it was the first like big publicized show that he did. And it was just like a moment of like, holy shit, dude, if you build it, they will come. Right. And we built this thing where it was like, and the idea of Louis even coming, it was sort of thrown out there. Like we had a lot of mutual friends and, you know, we heard that he might pop in and hang, and we were like, oh shit, how cool would that be? Cause we weren't booking him on it.
It wasn't something crazy or far fetched that
the producers weren't like reaching out to him, trying to get him to do it. It was simply like, we built something that was so cool that a guy who had essentially been in hiding, who was one of the greatest living comedians, said, I want to go and be a part of that, you know? And it was a really cool experience, you know, just having a conversation with him. He told me that he watched my special, which was really cool. And he said he loved it. It was just this great, like this whole, the whole 20, 30 minutes sort of surrounding that and just watching the audience. I mean, it gives me goosebumps thinking about it. It was just fucking incredible. Really, really incredible. So,
good for you. I'm glad you experienced that.
Besides my son being born, it was just a feeling of greatness overall that I felt. But all right, so anyway, Jerry's parents, they want him to come to a family gathering. It is his mother's second cousin's 50th wedding anniversary, okay. Which is like, Jesus Christ, dude, I won't go to my best friend's.
I mean, I get nervous for the baby's birthday. Like on Bianca's birthday, I'm like, oh, I hope Uncle Lou's going to come. I hope he's not busy somewhere. Like, I hope he's going to make it.
I would never take off anything for Bianca's birthday. Just so you know, that doesn't even register to me as an event.
For
it's like
kid's birthday. What
if I happen to be around and alive when her birthday comes about? I
mark it like months out. I'm like, Louis, you have to come like 2 months out, July. Just don't be doing anything.
No. I don't give a shit at all. But I love her. I love her to death. But you know what it is? I maybe it's because I can't look past my own view on birthdays, which are just stupid.
Yeah, no.
I don't give a fuck about a birthday. My own birthday, it's awkward and weird. I've never thrown myself a party. That's just not what I do. I think it's just another fucking day. Right? And I love Bianca. I see Bianca two, three times a week. You know?
Yeah, no. I get it.
So, they want Jerry to come to the family gathering. He's like, oh, I don't really want to go. But he decides that he's going to go anyway. Kramer shows up, and Kramer, his wacky thing this week is that he is changing the configuration of his apartment. He wants to get rid of all of his furniture, and he wants to build levels in his apartment, which I don't even understand. I can't even visualize what that means. Does he want to build like almost in the center, it's on the ground, and then levels up, like bleachers are all around on all four walls?
Who's that little video game guy? That's what I was picturing. It's like a little guy who pops on the levels.
Mario,
like blocks,
Sonic,
no.
Pitfall, for God's sakes. You're literally, you're naming every video
Cuber.
Game.
Is it Cuber?
Maybe
it might be Cuber. That's what I was picturing. I was picturing like a block, and then you get some steps up and some pillows and another block.
Some pillows everywhere, just fucking levels.
The way you described it, I was like, good from, yes, that guy, Cuber.
Yeah, very.
That's what I was picturing in my brain.
Okay. All right. So Jerry is like, you're not going to do this. And Kramer's like, I am Jerry. Oh, I'm going to do it.
He's such a hater, Jerry. He's such a hater.
So Jerry and Kramer make a bet, and Jerry's like, I'll bet you won't do it. He's like, I'm going to do it within a month. And Jerry's like, this is the hardest I laughed at Jerry so far. So he was like, I'll give you a year. It's just, he has no faith that Kramer's going to build this.
Loving
that. So they end up betting dinner, including dessert, that Kramer will not have this project done within a month. Next scene, they go to the family gathering. Kind of funny. They add an extra table at the end of the table, and it's a shorter table. So Elaine's sitting down at this table below Jerry. And she's just hilarious.
Like an idiot.
She's like an asshole. So let's see. Let's see, Jerry. Okay, so this is where the pony remark happens.
Oh my god, it's amazing.
It's a great little moment in the show. So this is where they name the actual episode. They're all talking. How do ponies even get brought up?
Oh, something with Elaine, right? Because Elaine brought it up.
Yeah, she did bring up the pony. Well, she brings it up somehow or another. And Jerry starts just sort of riffing, having a moment. She's trying to be funny at a party, which I completely get, this sort of foot in your mouth moment.
Amazing.
He's like, who has ponies? I hate ponies. And he's like, you know what? You know who I hated? I hated kids who had ponies. And at that point, his mom's second cousin, who's an old lady. What's her name? Manya? Yeah, her name is Manya. She's like an 80-year-old woman. She's Polish. She's like, Jerry, I had the pony growing up. And she goes into how all of her siblings had ponies and she had a pony back in Poland.
That's amazing. She was wondering. She was amazing. She was a great actress.
And she and Jerry is sort of like, oh, what? I'm just kidding. So she gets pissed off, this old lady.
And wheels herself out.
And she says, fuck. She was like, no, I must go. And she runs out of the room and she's so upset. Next scene, they're back at Jerry's apartment. Listen, but even before we even get there, just take a moment. I mean, what the fuck is a pony? I don't even know what a pony is.
Oh, you don't know what a pony is?
I mean, I know what a pony is, but what the fuck is it? Like, what is it? What is this a fucking pony? What's the point of it?
Is this like real life?
What do you mean?
Like, you don't know what a pony is. This is wild.
Give me the background of a pony. What is a pony?
A baby horse.
It's not a... Are you fucking kidding me? Are you kidding me?
A tiny horse.
Are you fucking kidding me?
Oh, my God.
She just said a baby horse, everyone. I want to point out that my sister just made fun of me, trashed me to my face for not knowing what a pony is.
What's a pony?
When I was asking like a philosophical question, obviously, this bitch comes back with a baby horse. It's not a baby horse. It's a fucking pony. How, Harrington, do me a favor, look up how much does a pony cost?
What's a pony?
What is a pony? Also, look up what is a pony? I don't know.
I mean a horse.
Jenny, it's not a horse. It's not a baby horse. Are you kidding? You're not
joking at all.
You're not joking. Talking to your microphone.
I'm not joking at all.
Not joking. You legitimately think a pony is a baby horse.
Yeah.
Are you kidding me? Are you fucking kidding me? You are that stupid.
This is
the greatest moment in the history of this show because my sister is legitimately mentally fucking retarded and it's making me so happy. You think a pony's a baby horse? Harrington, I'm only 90% sure that a pony's not a baby horse, so please look this up and confirm with me. It is a completely different species. Not a species. I don't know. I understand that it's a small horse.
I mean, is that such a wild, far-fetched thing that I would say it's a little baby horse?
No. No. Wow. It's not a baby. You don't call a fucking newborn horse a pony.
What do you call it? calf. A calf.
Is it a calf?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Fowl. Shut up, Harrington. You don't know
a fowl.
Dick about
a bird,
shit.
You fucking retard. Were you sleeping when you thought of that?
There's no dick about shit, Harrington.
A baby
Beat
horse
it.
Is not a fowl. And if it is, I'll give you nothing because you shouldn't have showed me. And it's... Is that how you pronounce it? It's a
foal.
Foal, Harrington, not a fowl. Fowl is a chicken.
Ugh, dummy.
Foal, and we all knew that. We were testing you.
Testing you. So we knew everything all along.
So I don't understand a pony. I don't know anybody who had a pony growing up. That is like some highfalutin
shit. No, that's, yeah.
I
love this whole monologue about the pony. That was hilarious, too.
I never even rode a pony. Fucking proving us wrong on our own show, dude. This is why Harrington doesn't understand.
That's why we hate you.
Wait, can I explain to people something about podcasts? When you produce a podcast, you're supposed to make your host feel like fucking rock stars.
Yeah. Like, you're like assholes waiting for him.
Rock stars. And this guy, every turn, is making us feel smaller and fucking smaller. Fine, it's a foul, Harrington.
Fine.
Got it. You got it. You won. Are you happy now? You beat us, and you made the hosts of the show.
Let's give him a raise.
Yeah, why not, Harrington? Why not? You show up fucking late. You make us look like assholes. I get it. You're right. So I don't know anybody who had a pony. Or any sort of exotic pets growing up. How much does a pony cost?
Remember, one kid had ferrets. I never liked ferrets because of that kid.
I just spoke about ferrets the other day on the Real Ass podcast, and I spoke about this kid. It was Joey Celentano.
Yeah.
Who had ferrets. And this is the kid who almost shot me in the face with an automatic BB gun.
That kid used to walk around with like an AR-14 up and down the street. He was like...
Yeah, he was like upset. Since he was like 10, he was obsessed with becoming a fucking neo-Nazi military fucking guy.
It was crazy.
Yeah, so Joey Celentano, he used to have ferrets, and they were wild creatures.
Ugh, they were disgusting and smelly, and they had a big cage, and they pissed everywhere.
Yeah, they stunk. They're awful creatures.
Yeah, why would... And, like, to get so many of them, like, just... I don't know, just the feeling of them crawling in your body. I'm like, ugh.
Harrington, how much is a pony?
What?
I'll buy a pony cheaper than a Doberman Pinscher?
Let's get one for the kids each.
I'll get two ponies.
Let's get two ponies. How much? How much do we have to pay you to take care of our ponies?
You feed them carrots. In fact, if you want the pony to walk, you sit on it and you put a carrot on a string in front of it, and then the pony will ride you everywhere want to go. How much does it cost to feed it? Is it like tigers? Can you remember from Tiger King? We learned that a baby tiger costs like $4,000.
So cheap.
And everyone's like, what? I'll buy a baby tiger right now. And you find out they eat $800 per day in meat. Oh, shit. Has there been music on the whole time?
Oh, no. Did we talk over music the whole time?
Maybe. Who knows?
Harrington.
How much does it cost to feed a pony? This is literally nothing.
Nothing.
This is nothing. My kid is going to have a fucking pony. It's cheaper than Harrington the house.
Oh my gosh.
And more talented of a producer. I guarantee you we could have this pony produce the podcast and it would do a better job.
Dangle a carrot.
It would be on time. Guaranteed fucking teed. I had no idea how cheap a pony was.
That's amazing.
What's the life expectancy of a pony? It's like 3 months. I got to deal with it. Fucking get a new pony every few months. This is great. Because I was thinking about getting my son a gift anyway.
Yeah, the sugar gliders are a really bad idea. Let's not do that.
Oh, yeah. I found a girl after I talked about sugar gliders on Real Estate Podcast DM'd me. And she was like, listen to me. I've had sugar gliders my whole life. Uh-huh. She was like, they're not good pets for kids.
No.
They shit and piss everywhere. Yeah. She was like, sometimes they fly into your boiling pot of water and they kill themselves by accident. They drown themselves in the toilet regularly. But they are adorable.
Yeah, well, you were talking about it and I was showing back. I was like, oh, look, Uncle Lou's going to get this. And as you were talking, you were talking about them biting and I was just looking at his little fangs and I was like, oh, that's going to like chew their little hands up. And
would just fucking attack.
Yeah, no, know, anything like that, yeah.
I'm legitimately thinking about getting the kids a pony, though.
A pony would be so fun. I'll help take care of the pony.
I spend more on the fucking drum set.
I'll take care of the pony. Let's do it.
But now if I don't want to house it, let's say I just want to house it in my garage, because I can clear out half the garage for the pony. I'm not using that much of the workout equipment, to be honest with you.
Not on the sauna side, though.
So it's less than an Equinox membership to house this pony.
Oh, my God.
And it costs $1,200 annually to feed this pony. That's $100 per month.
What?
This is nothing. Nothing. 25 to 30 years. Longer than my sister.
Forever.
Okay, so Manya leaves. She's very, very upset. They go back to Jerry's apartment, and Jerry's parents are leaving. They're getting ready to go back to Florida. Kramer comes in. This is a very funny moment. This is probably my favorite moment in the show. But Kramer comes in. Oh, the dad asks, "Was like, Kramer, how's your leveling idea going?" And Kramer's like, "Nah, I'm not gonna do it." And then Jerry's like, okay, so I won the bet. When am I getting that dinner? And Kramer's like, no, the bet's off. Jerry's like, what do you mean the bet's off? He's like, yeah, I'm just not going to do it. He's like, no, that was the bet. Whether you're going to do this within a month, that was the bet. That was the entire bet. And he's like, no. He's like, I don't want to do it. I could do it if I wanted to. And they have a little funny moment. It's pretty funny. And then Jerry gets a phone call in the middle of this. As his parents leave, they go get into a taxi. And Jerry gets a call, and he looks very sad, and he calls down, and we find out that Manya the old lady, the Polish lady, whose 50th anniversary it was, who had the pony, she died. She died.
Very sad moment.
Very sad moment in the show. Okay. So the parents come back up, and Jerry's mom alludes to the fact that Jerry's pony comment might have been what sent her over the edge. Yeah, this is a funny episode. You know, I'm gonna give her four bagels.
Right.
I'm gonna
give her four so fucking funny. Bagels. I'm so laughing. Many moments.
I'm laughing talking about it
so
right now.
So many moments.
Yeah. So Jerry's dad is worried about the money, and they find out the funeral is Wednesday. Now, we didn't say this before, but Jerry, when he made that winning play in the softball game, turns out his softball team got into the championship, which is also going to be Wednesday. So the funeral ends up falling the same day as the game. Not only would I have not showed up to the 50th wedding anniversary, there's no fucking chance that I'm showing up to this old bitch's funeral.
No way.
I barely went to my mom's funeral. 50-50 nope. shot I was going to be selling comedy club tickets instead of going to my mom's funeral.
No. 30-20. 80-20.
Wow. So, I didn't go to my Grandma Rose's funeral.
Well, I know this bitch. You definitely were not coming to her funeral.
My Grandma Rose.
You're going to come to Anna's. You'll come to
raise
mine.
Me. My Grandma Rose, my great Grandma Rose helped raise me. She, in kindergarten, walked me to school every single day. Every day. She died. I didn't even think about going to her funeral.
Oh, you're a monster. What is wrong with you? Why didn't you want to do that? Why didn't you want to come to her funeral?
I don't like funerals.
Nobody does.
Imagine somebody likes funerals. You know, I just love a funeral.
Good funeral right now.
I love a funeral. I really do. No. I don't like hospitals. I don't like funerals.
Nobody does.
I don't like anything that... I've had enough sadness in my life.
Nobody does. You got to just do it. Suck it up.
I've had enough sadness in my life that I don't need to add more sadness to my life by paying respect to the dead. I don't watch sad movies.
I don't watch sad movies.
If I find out a movie's sad, it's nope. not happening.
Nope.
What's the saddest movie you've ever seen?
Precious. I mean, that was just moment after moment of like, ugh.
You compare the mother from Precious to our mother.
Yes.
I've never saw Precious.
You don't want to. I mean, it was just brutal. Just, ugh. Poor kid.
But I don't know, but apparently the mother in Precious was really bad. Are you exaggerating?
No. That was our mother. Yeah. I mean, without like there was a lot of sexual abuse. So like without that aspect.
Yeah, she didn't fuck us. No. You know what? At least she would have made us come. But no. We didn't even get that. It was worse.
Ugh.
Did I ever tell you I had a sexually better mother?
Yeah. You know what that just means? It's a sign of closeness.
I did tell you I had a sexually better mother?
I might have heard it on your podcast.
On a podcast, I listen. Yeah. I had a dream that I didn't have sex with her. She was lying naked with a cantaloupe in between her legs. And she had cut a hole in the cantaloupe. And I was fucking the cantaloupe that was in between her legs. So.
I don't even know what to tell you. I actually analyze dreams, and that to me, sex dreams aren't about sex. They're about feeling close to somebody. So you might have felt particularly close to her at that time.
Or maybe I felt close to a cantaloupe. She was just there. It's just fucking interrupting my cantaloupe lovemaking session.
Maybe, I don't know. Maybe. But you know, you felt close.
So Jerry doesn't want to go to the funeral. I'm not a big funeral guy. I don't, you know. A friend of mine died like a year and a half ago, and I didn't go.
See, that's terrible. Do you
what
at least send
do?
Something? Do you send something?
I'm going to fucking send a bouquet
send
of flowers.
Send flowers, yes. Oh. A fruit platter.
Who is that for?
A fruit thing.
Who is that for? It's for the fucking family?
For the family, yes, to show your respects. They don't need... To let them know you're thinking about them.
Flowers mean nothing. That is an empty gesture.
Your girlfriend know you feel this way.
Good. And I will go to Amory's funeral. Amory helped to raise me. I love my aunt Amory. I'll go to your funeral.
Good.
Probably. We'll see. But Jerry doesn't want to go to this funeral, and he has sort of this debate. He didn't even know her that well. He's got the championship game. The fact that he had something that was legitimately important to him to do. I would have had no problem with Jerry not going to this funeral, but he is a fucking good guy, and he goes to the funeral. Just craziness.
And his mom was nice. She didn't even pressure him. She was like, whatever you want to do.
Yeah, she said, Jerry, you don't have to go.
You know?
And he just felt guilty. This is the difference between me and Jerry fucking Seinfeld. Once again, the big difference between me and Jerry, I would not have went to that funeral. I would have taken pride in the fact that my pony remark killed this old lady. Like, that's how fucking good that joke was. Yeah. I murdered an old lady with a joke. I swear to God, we'd talk about it on Legion of Skinks for the next year straight. Pony murder. Next stand-up bit was pretty funny. He talks about he doesn't understand funerals. He was like, we don't understand the dead, which is pretty pretty interesting perspective. He was like, we give them a pillow and a suit. Are they going to sleep? Or are they going somewhere important? That was pretty funny. It was decent. So next scene, they're at the diner. Jerry, Elaine, and George are in the diner talking. I feel like they just threw George into the episode here for no reason.
Yeah. I was thinking he wasn't even going to be in it at all.
Yeah, he had no reason to be in this episode. I guess he was on the softball team.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. So, yeah, they're just talking about their own mortality. And yeah, just sort of making the good point. Yeah, dead people don't know who comes to the funeral.
They might. Maybe they do.
They don't. Do you believe in spirit and fucking some sort of consciousness after death? Do you think that our mother's watching down upon us right
yes,
now?
Yes, I do. I believe in energy. I believe there's in the universe. I believe there's energy out there.
Basic
whatever.
Bitch answer.
I don't care.
I believe in energy.
I'm going to go as far as to say I'm an empath, and yes.
That is
you
literally...
You have to look for signs from the universe.
I've
yes.
talked about this before. I've talked about it on stage. I was like, that is a sign of a simple, simple-minded woman. Only women believe in that. I believe in energy. I believe in energy.
What do you believe?
I don't believe in anything. I believe that once you're dead, you're
blank,
dead.
Done. You've never seen a sign from the universe. You've never seen a sign that you said, damn, that's weird.
No.
We have found a ladybug in January in a box upstairs.
That's the sign you bring up.
That was our mother visiting us as a ladybug. Yes.
I threw that ladybug directly into the coal.
He did. He just threw it out.
I picked it up and I went, goodbye, Mom. Goodbye. You remember when I fucked that cantaloupe?
They were all cheering for him to throw the ladybug outside. I was like, no.
Nobody wanted you know what a ladybug is? It's a beetle. You know what a beetle is? A different type of cockroach. Nobody wants a little fucking red pretty cockroach in the house.
Well, that's what I believe in. What do you believe in? Nothing. Well, okay.
Is there any sort of connection between a ladybug and our mother? Why do you think that that's our mother? I don't understand.
It's just a sign. It was weird that it was the middle of January. There's no bugs right now. Like, where are there bugs?
In our house.
Clearly.
It's fucking an ant problem down here. Apparently a ladybug problem upstairs. So yeah, I guess they're...
Okay, can I give you one more example?
What?
Like in pictures. Like, do you remember the picture of Bianca and James walking down the street and there's like a white, like a light shadow next to them? Like, there's something standing there next to them.
She's talking about sunlight, guys.
No, it's not.
I'm telling you, I know the picture you're talking about. Nope. And she was like, that's our mom right there. It is light coming through the clouds. Like,
okay.
No, yeah, if you're looking for those signs, I say this about microaggressions, and I say this about racism, and I say this about everything. If you're looking for it, you'll find it. If I wanted to look for signs in this room right now, if I really wanted to look for in my notes, I was like, oh my God, this kind of looks like our mother's face. If you turn the page, it's fucking retarded. When people find Jesus Christ in a piece of breakfast toast, right, in the shading of the toast, it's not because Jesus showed up. It's because it's a coincidence and it looks that way and you're looking for it.
It could very well be. I can be proven wrong. Well, one way to find out.
But this is the thing, because I don't believe in any sort of afterlife or God or anything like that, I think it's easier for me to say fuck off to a funeral.
Maybe, yeah.
You know, it's like, because at that point, it's just me going there to be sad, be around a dead body, which is bizarre. Dead bodies are fucked up.
Yeah.
They're all rubbery looking.
Yeah, I hate it. I hate everything about it. Like, I try to avoid it. Like, I'll justify going to, like, not a lot of funerals. Like, I can say, okay, I barely knew that person. I don't really care.
We went to a Rema Jane's funeral.
That was so depressing.
Poor person funerals.
They're the worst.
I couldn't be any sadder. Think about a way that you can make a funeral sadder.
Sadder. Let's make it sadder.
It's just make it for somebody who has no money. It's the cheapest coffin you could buy. It looks cheap.
I mean,
there's no flowers. There's no pictures. There's no nothing. It's just a body in a box.
The priest barely wants to be there.
It is goddamn awful. So, yeah, I'm not a big fan. They go to the funeral, and the person speaking talks about how much Manya loved her pony. Who's the guy that was speaking? He's been in so much stuff. He's a major actor.
I'm not good at this game.
Major actor. Harrington, look up the guy speaking at the funeral. Major actor, been in a bunch of different things. I forget.
Al Pacino.
No, it wasn't like that. But he does like minor roles, been on a lot of TV shows, been in a lot of movies. He plays a doctor. One fucking, trying to remember what it was. And pull up his IMDb while you're at it, Harrington. So they're at the funeral the whole time, and Elaine is trying to find out what the husband of Manya is going to do at the apartment, because we find out that he's going to move to Phoenix.
Yep.
And he's sad. You know, his wife just 50 years just died, but he's going to go live with his brother in Phoenix. So Elaine is trying to find out what he's going to do with his apartment. Because
yeah, she's a hustler.
Yeah, she's a fucking hustler. I love Elaine. Little fucking sexy firecracker bitch.
$300 a month apartment.
Yeah, $300 a month for rent-controlled apartment. If you guys don't know about New York City, I think this is probably the only city in the world. Maybe not. Yeah, maybe not. Wild. There's probably other big cities that do this as well. But in New York City, rent-controlled apartments are a very, very big thing. So what happens is if an apartment was rented before a certain year, the way it was, the leases essentially didn't enable them to raise the rent. So these old people that have been living in New York City forever, they pay ridiculously cheap rent prices. But as soon as they die, then the apartment skyrockets and they get to go up. So,
but they like pass it on, don't they? Because I knew somebody whose grandmother had one and like gave it to her. Like
they're not really allowed to. Technically, they're not allowed to. But they do it. They just pretend and they keep it.
Like a beautiful apartment for like crazy cheap.
What were you going to say, Harrington? Dr. Silverman and Terminator. Yes, that's exactly what I was thinking. It's exactly what I was thinking. Fuck yes. Fuck yes. It was the guy who was being abusive to the mom. Terminator 2, actually. He was in.
Wow.
Yeah, 100%. That was the doctor. What else was he in? Give me some other things. Terminator 3, Terminator 4.
Terminator
okay, besides
4,
Terminators.
Return of the...
Naked Gun.
I wonder if those still hold up. We should look back on that. Yeah.
Probably. I thought
we thought they were funny when we were younger.
Oh, yeah. So, yeah, Elaine's like, the husband is having sort of his own conversation talking about moving to Arizona, and Elaine's just like, so what are you going to do with the apartment? And he's not hearing her. So at one point, this is a funny moment, he asks, he's like, I don't even know why I should be bringing my winter clothes to Arizona. I don't know how hot it is. And she's like, I have an idea. Why don't you leave your winter clothes in your apartment and I will watch them. I'll move in to watch your clothes. And yeah, we find out that he's giving it to his nephew or whatever. So, so right at the end of the funeral's ending, and Jerry's really upset because he didn't get to go play in his game. The funeral starts at 2 p.m. The game starts at 2:45 p.m. So right when he's getting out of the funeral, the game is starting, and he's kind of like, God damn it. The game's starting right now. I can't believe it. The sky opens up and it starts pouring down rain.
Blessing in disguise.
Yep. Blessing in disguise. He's like, holy shit, wait a minute. This means the game's going to be canceled. It's going to be rescheduled. I'm going to get to play in it. So he goes and plays in the game. We don't see that. All we see is the aftermath of the game. The very next scene is they're at the diner and Jerry's very upset because he blew the game. He blew it.
Worst moment of his life.
And he describes it as the worst moment of his life, which makes me ask you, what is the worst moment of your life? Because the worst moment of my life? You describing the best moment of your life.
Oh,
that was disgusting.
Fine.
It made me sick.
That's my new best moment of my life.
Okay, good. Look at that. What's the worst moment of your life? Single worst moment.
I don't even know.
I mean, you did compare our mother to the mother from Precious.
Yeah, that's more of a child and not just a
moment. That's
not
moment. A
moment.
I
can pinpoint. I mean,
13,
years?
14 years of abuse.
I really don't know. I don't know. I mean, I guess I could have had it a lot worse.
All right. Most embarrassed you've ever been. How about that?
Most embarrassed?
You're thinking about it right now. What's the most embarrassed you've ever been? Gee, you have to put yourself out there. You're thinking.
I mean, giving birth is probably the most embarrassed I've ever been. Yeah.
You've been more embarrassed. You told me a story about pooping in a hot guy's apartment that sounded more embarrassing.
No, get out of here. That never happened. Ew, you're so disgusting. No, giving birth. You have your junk hanging out for the whole world. Ugh.
You know,
terrible.
Men call their junk their penis.
You got all that junk just chilling out there. It was terrible. Oh my God. You don't even feel like a human being anymore. You got your like your boobs. Like it's just awful. Yeah, that's pretty embarrassing.
Worst moment of my life. Worst moment of my life. Kind of weird because I talk about all the tragedy that's happened in my life. I mean, I don't want to make it sad, but I think I know the worst moment in my life.
What?
When I caught our mother stealing out of my wallet.
Oh, really? Oh.
That was really bad. That was really terrible. That was terrible. I had just gotten a job in the city. And I was finally making like a little bit, nothing even crazy, like $400 or $500 a week. I was making selling comedy club tickets. But to us, $500 a week when we were kids.
Yeah. Oh my God. So much.
Rich.
Crazy.
I mean, we were like, what the fuck? Like this girl. My mother never made, I don't think I remember ever her making more than $200 a week.
Yeah. I remember like $300 a week and I'd be like, all right, she's doing all right.
All right,
like,
mom. There you go.
Go get it.
She's making $16,000 a year. This fucking bitch is crushing. I shit you not. Like that was, we were on Section 8. We were on welfare. food stamps, just my entire childhood. Like every time my mom would go pay for groceries, I would disappear in the supermarket because I didn't want to be seen paying with food stamps.
That was the worst.
I was always so conscious of how poor we were. It was such a major thing. Us not being
able
to
say those are like embarrassing moments, but like that's not, I mean,
but no, that's not what I'm saying is like, I'm explaining sort of the relevancy of her stealing money from me, mm-hmm. you know? So it's like, we did all this. I had a big falling out with my mom years before. Like it was like really shitty and contentious. And I came home from being in the city. My girlfriend was living in the city, so I'd stay with her a lot of the times in the city. But I came home to like visit or whatever. I was still half living at home, half not. I was always like out, you know, living on a friend's couch or whatever. Since I was essentially sick, since I could drive, I stopped coming home every night. But I came home and I had like, you know, maybe $400 in my wallet. And I just smoked a blunt on the balcony. And I was high as fuck. And I know I stunk. And I heard her get up and I was like, fuck. She got up. I know she's going to give me shit. She knew I smoked, but she just wasn't happy about it. So I lied down on the couch and I pretended to be asleep. And I watched her come in, look at me. I'm literally watching this with one eye open. Watch her come in, look
she's
at
like,
me.
She's like, good, he's high, that, yeah. that junkie.
This fucking high sleeping idiot. Now it's time to take advantage. I watched her do this good. With her fingers.
Sleep.
Yeah, and she fuck, I just watched her go into my jeans were on the dining room table. Like I'd taken them off and they're on the dining room table. I watched her pick up my jeans, go into my wallet. And start rifling through the money and pull money out of it.
Yeah, she stole money from me too, by the way. Yeah.
And then I was like, "What are you doing?" And she was like, embarrassed. She had nothing to say to it. She was fucking, you know, it was really.
She justified herself to me. She like tried to justify it.
What was the justification to you? How was it?
That because I was still living with her.
Okay.
So she justified it as I should be paying rent.
So she would she went into your room and just took money?
Yeah, like I went in my wallet and like $80 was just missing.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
And I just got really annoyed because I had plans the next day. Like, I think we were going to, like, amusement park or something. So,
good
like,
riddance.
No, stop it. I forgave her. It's fine.
Now I forgive her.
Yeah.
But I didn't forgive her while she was alive.
No, you did not.
When she's talking about, like, please forgive me and all that, that's what she's talking about. That was, like, the moment that I was, like, I'm done. And I really never spoke to her again. Like, we spoke randomly a couple times. We like, a holiday once. But I was just sort of, like.
Over it.
And it was just sort of like, I don't know, I just worked so fucking hard. What I had to do to make that money, you have to like, it would be embarrassing. You have to go stand on a street corner and fucking stop people and try to get them to buy comedy club tickets from you. It was really shitty, hard work. It was the first time that I was ever making money in my entire life. And it was just so like, I don't know, like you're supposed to give to your kids. You're not supposed to take.
Yeah.
You know, and that was just sort of the thing that like, yeah, it was the reason I say it's the worst moment of my life, it wasn't like this crazy, devastating moment. Like, she didn't take the money. That wasn't the issue.
Yeah, no.
The issue was something that I kind of regret in retrospect, not at least forgiving her, having a conversation, coming to, you know, terms with it. If I think back of all these moments in my life, now I would have just pretended to be asleep. Now yeah. I would have just said it. Fuck it. Let her just have it. Who cares? It wasn't, you know, worthwhile. But yeah, that was a pretty...
I think for her, though, it was like... probably the lowest point I'd ever seen in her life. Even when she was younger, I feel like, you know, when you're younger, there's still that kind of hope of like
yeah.
getting past it and getting clean and being able to like, you know, get your shit together. And
yeah.
she did have young kids that she needed to live for. So like, I feel like at that point in her life, like it was just kind of over. And I feel like she
had cancer. She had relapsed on drugs.
Yeah,
her mom
she
died.
Realized her life had just spiraled out
so
of control.
So when my Grandma Jane died, my Grandma Jane was, I'm assuming, a major drug dealer.
In Patterson, New Jersey.
In Patterson,
Hell
New Jersey.
Yeah, dude.
She had a dresser full of prescription drugs. Just full.
And I opened the cabinet, and I mean, Louis, I shit you not, it was pills. I mean, hundreds of bottles of pills. It
yeah,
was
it was
wild.
It was crazy. I mean, knowing what I know now.
Whatever, what was it? Fentanyl?
We
would have
gotten
it was,
fucked up.
No, I would have been.
Shit. I sold the shit out of it?
Yeah.
Maybe. My mother,
you know, the cops used to sit outside her house and watch her house.
Oh, I'm sure.
Like for people coming in and out, coming and going and stuff. Like the
Grandma
FBI.
Grandma Candy, baby.
Dude.
We called her Grandma Candy.
It was why she had money hidden everywhere in the house because my mother told me why. She was like, she explained it. Like when the cops come, if they find a bundle of cash, chances are they're not going to keep looking. They're not going to find all the cash. You know what I mean? You
yeah.
don't want the cash in one spot. So if they're looking for it.
Yeah. Real junkie mentality.
Real crazy. I mean, she had a safe in the bank. What was it? Like a safe deposit box with like a bunch of
shitty
cash,
shitty jewelry,
coins, yeah,
coins, things she was collecting.
Coins were
Elvis
ridiculous.
Elvis Presley pictures.
Oh my god.
My grandma was a crazy woman.
A crazy woman.
But my grandma dying, my mother's mother dying, sent her over the edge.
Yeah, well, she found all those pills.
When she found all those pills, my mother had been on methadone essentially her whole childhood. And when she found those pills, that sent her into a relapse on drugs because she started. But at that point, she was so like she had cancer. She had given up on like fighting the cancer.
Yeah,
she
wasn't work anymore. Really, like,
she couldn't speak. She was whispering. So it was sort of like a. It was she was in a really dark, sad, fucked up place.
And then she lost her son.
And then she lost her son. I mean, hey, look, that was on her. The onus was on her to fix it. It wasn't on me. I just feel bad that I didn't because
no, but, and you were a kid.
I'm almost fucking 40 now, and I can look back and go like, absolutely. "Oh shit!" Like I could have handled it differently. But the onus wasn't on me as a child to be the responsible one or be the mature one.
Can I tell you something?
What?
She knows this. She forgives you.
I think she's watching.
Yes, I do.
A ladybug just landed on your nose.
Oh my god!
A ladybug is in my wallet. What the fuck? She's trying to take the money again.
One comes out of your mouth.
Oh. Is a ladybug writing down my credit card number right now? What the fuck is going on here? So, that's really that. And the husband says he doesn't blame Jerry. He says she was fine. She was over it. And then the show ends with him going into his final stand-up bit about ponies, which is a pretty funny bit. She's talking about, like, what is it? Almost like the conversation we had, like, what is a pony? It's like, please don't use them for crowd control. Could you imagine a cop showing up on a pony? He was like...
funny. I thought the stand-up in this one was funnier. I thought Jerry's timing was hilarious. I just thought this was such a funny episode. Just a funny, well-written... hilarious episode.
Yeah, Jerry was the funniest in this episode that he's been. Kramer was very funny in this episode as well.
So funny, yep. Yeah. This Elaine, even her little nuances, so funny.
This
so
is
cute.
Where Jerry really shined. This episode was the one where it was like, oh shit, Jerry's a funny comedic actor. The writing in this episode, like I said, all of the randomness of the conversations that were sort of happening around, it reminded me of Curb Your Enthusiasm. It reminded me, it was just cleverly written, like sort of like, you know, not the average person when there's writing dialogue, they wouldn't think to sort of go in these directions with it. So it was, in my opinion, the first example of it was like, oh shit, this show is really well written. Anything else before this, it was somewhat entertaining. It was okay. But yes, I'm going to give it, I'm changing my score. Four full bagels.
Four bagels, yes.
For this one, it's a big deal. Also, Minority Report. I didn't see any minorities.
I forgot to look, but I was hoping you had noticed. Yeah.
I forgot to look in the diner. Because that's usually where we got the minorities.
Yeah. Towards the end at the diner, I was looking because that's when I remembered. But yeah, I didn't notice any.
So yeah, let us know, obviously, Harrington and Bobby in post about the Minority Report because I'm sure they're out there.
Yeah, Harrington will really. Harrington's like, yeah, I'm right on that, boss.
So, that was the whole episode. Anything else that stood out?
No, I just thought it was so funny. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Five stars. Five bagels.
So this was it. This was the episode.
How many minutes is it, Harrington? Not long enough.
It's an hour episode. We do an hour every week. This
not
is what
long
we do.
Enough,
we an
guys.
Hour
no,
on
they want
Seinfeld.
More
sad stories about our mom. can we end every
more
episode
about heroin, guys?
With
what do you think?
A brutally sad story about our fucking junkie mother? Is that possible? Although a lot of people don't think that me and you are related or have the same father.
Yes. Oh my god, we get that a lot. We used to get that a lot.
Yeah, all the time.
Whatever.
All the time. But my mother was white. So it looked like my sister was my mother's natural child, and they just found this
adopted.
Little brown boy.
Little brown boy brought him in.
But no, if you actually look at me and my sister's face, we have a very similar. We have the same nose, same lips.
When I thin out, I think we look more alike too. Like when I'm a little slimmer, I think we resemble each other a little more.
Yeah.
And when you get fat,
And so yes, we do have the same father. We have the same mother. We don't look like my mother. We look like my father. We have my father's.
I don't
nose.
Know. I hear that I look like our mother a lot.
You look nothing like our mother.
I hear that. I do.
Our mother looks like a
like a. Heroin junkie.
No, she didn't look that junkie-ish. It's kind of funny because our mother cleaned up really nicely.
Yeah, no.
My mother went from looking, she could, because she had false teeth. So she could be a straight up junkie. She could look like a junkie and have no makeup on and just walk around in like dirty clothes and have no teeth and, you know, all high. Or she could look like she did when she would go to like Bruno's to work.
Do
she
you
had, like,
think anybody knew that she was a junkie or had been a junkie?
Yes.
Just by looking at her.
Not by looking at her, no.
No, that's what I'm saying. Just by looking at her, not knowing her history, but
maybe I'm just
naive. Yeah,
naive or whatever it is. But she had you could tell because she had like a money sign tattoo on her hand.
I mean, a prison tattoo.
Prison
on
tattoos.
Her hand.
My mother had only prison tattoos. She had a Playboy bunny.
Yeah.
She had
our
my
names
name,
on her
your
back.
Name, Hector, my father's name.
Yeah. Heck.
It just said Heck?
Heck, yeah.
Oh, I thought it said Hector.
And his prison number right under it.
No.
No, but would you have been that surprised about it?
No, I would not have been that surprised.
I wouldn't have been.
She also had a weird burn on her leg that she always told me was from sunburn, and now I don't know what it was actually from.
No, I believe it, yeah, because Amber, remember, she was in the hospital for that. She fell asleep in the sun with baby oil on.
It was a crazy sunburn, a nasty fucking burn.
No, I remember her saying, she had, I don't know, third-degree burns, and she was like, I can't imagine somebody in, a real fire with burns all over their body, because she said she was on her stomach in so much pain, crying.
Yeah.
That's how bad she was burned, and they had to do a skin graft or something on her legs. And that's what made that spot.
That wasn't
there.
A burn. That was a ladybug.
What?
All right, let's wrap this one. Thank you guys for watching this episode of Gomez Watches Seinfeld. Next week, we got season 2, episode 3 coming at you. If you guys love the show, go to gasdigitalnetwork.com. Use the promo code GWS. It gets you a 14-day free trial. The premium service on Gas Digital gets you access to the entire on-demand library for every Gas Digital show. There's all my other shows as well. It's Legion of Skanks, Real Ass Podcast, Believe You Me. 21 incredible shows here on the network. Thousands of hours of content that you cannot find anywhere else. Plus, you get access to the Racist Live Chat when the show premieres, which is a ton of fun. Ad-free and uncensored episodes. You'll see when we put these on YouTube, a lot of times we have to censor certain parts of the episode. So if you guys want to see it uncensored, go to gasdigitalnetwork.com. Use that promo code GWS. Also, right now, this is important. Go to our iTunes, leave us a 5-star rating, a positive review. If you're on Google Play, Stitcher, any of these platforms that you can rate and review shows, go do it. It really does help the show out. And you know what? If you have a friend who loves Seinfeld, recommend this podcast. I've been hearing from a lot of people that love Seinfeld that they really enjoy listening to our breakdowns because
really?
We're so ignorant.
No.
And we have no idea what's going on with the show.
Oh, God.
By the way, we still don't know.
I hear
Jerry.
Them saying that they hate us and they don't think we talk enough about Seinfeld.
Jenny, that's one out of every 30 comments. Stop focusing on the negative. Start focusing on the positive. It's all positivity. Okay. Thank you guys for watching. We'll be back next.